interesting presentation today. Before we start, just a couple of announcements. Bathrooms out to the right. Please turn down your cell phones, put them on vibrate, or turn them off, please. And before we disperse today, I wanted to acknowledge several people who have helped put this class on. First of all, Tom and Bridget Bull have been, at least in my way of thinking, pretty well invisible during this whole presentation. And they volunteered to do this, and I just want to give them a round of applause. Their product eventually will work its way to the library back here, and anybody who hasn't attended the courses, or if you missed a class or two, that DVD will be available to us at the library back there. I also wanted to thank Al Fuller and Jonathan Weil for facilitating, my wife Kristen for taking photos during the class, so we had pictures of all the speakers that we'll have available. Judy and Jay Cooper for putting the planning together for the Navy show, the first one we had. And then Al, for organizing the 4:42 presentation that we had from Florence Ochi. And Sally Russell for last week's WASP, that was really great. And Dila Davinsky for today's presentation that we'll introduce in a second here. So thanks to all of those people. I just wanted to mention that next fall we'll have some more World War II stories to tell. Al and Jonathan and I have been talking to a group of Pearl Harbor survivors, and we'll have one session at Pearl Harbor. They only want to do one session, these guys. So hopefully there are 8 of them now, and they keep telling me, you've got to hurry up and get this going, because we may not be here next course. I hear that a lot in putting these courses together, so cross your fingers, but we do have that group. In addition to that, Florence Ochi, when she was here, told Al that she'd like to bring a presentation on the Japanese-American participation in the Military Intelligence Service, the MIS. So we're going to have that as part two of that. In addition to that, Judy Foreman is putting together a course, or thinking about putting together a course, on the German POW camp in Garden Grove that there was. And Fred Stern has proposed a class called Schindler's List, and I'm not sure what all Fred has intended for that, but that's another course that will be offered hopefully next fall as well. So keep your eyes open. I think there will be some more topics that will be of interest at that time. So our speaker today is Gila Davinsky, who will talk about our topic of the day here, the second generation. Many of you know Gila. I think she may hold the record for the most classes attended by an OLLI member. 20 of them, 20 classes that you were in this fall. So you probably, if you don't know Gila personally, you have seen her and know that she goes to an awful lot of classes. Gila brought this idea for this class to us about a year ago or so, something like that, and has done a lot of background research since that time and has brought in a series of documentary videos that we'll be taking a look at. Some or all of these, and I put them on here. This will be on the blog, so there's no reason to try to read that. Impossible to copy right in there. But we'll post these on the blog, and you'll be able to go in and see at least two of these for sure, and probably some more that we'll try to get to today as we talk. But Gila's going to tell us about her life as a child of two Auschwitz survivors. And then she's done another, I think, a pretty courageous job on putting all of this together and telling her story. But the second part after the break will be stories of Nazi children and two documentaries that ask them the same questions. Well, what's it like to be the child of a Nazi elite member? And these are all the Nazi leaders that had children or offspring that were interviewed for this. So I'm not going to say too much more because I'll cut into Gila's story. So, Gila?
Morning. Everyone can hear me well? So when I suggested this presentation to Gary, I didn't think he would choose me, and then he said, you should do it, and I couldn't back down, so he was stuck with me. And as you can hear, I have ever so slight an accent. So if you can't understand what I'm saying, ask me and I will try to say it more clearly, otherwise it wouldn't be much good. And hopefully you could hear this part, because otherwise you would know to ask me. So I'm going to start first with a little background of my parents before I get to what is was for me to grow up as a second generation. So this is my dad, Shmuel Dubinsky. I will go there again just to show you. My mom, Esther Dubinsky Levy. This is my father's brother, Yoshua. He also went through the Holocaust. My brother, my sister-in-law, and my niece and nephew. So my father, Shmuel Dubinsky, was born in a small town, probably will be called village, in Poland, called Jaluszice, near Krakow. And he was the youngest of six sons. And he was born in 1921. And the Nazis invaded Poland in the 1st of September 1939. In 1941, he went to the first camp. It was a labor camp near Krakow. And then he went to Plaszow. Plaszow was a camp where Schindler was, but he wasn't part of the Schindler's list, he was just in that camp. He was also in Mauthausen and in Linz. And in Linz, this is where he was liberated by Americans. And then was moved to Modena, to Italy, by the Jewish Brigade. And went to southern Italy, and from there he came to Palestine. There was no Israel yet. And the British had, I don't know if you know, they had a mandate over Palestine, so they did not allow Jews to come freely, even during the war and after the war, to Palestine. So in 1945, my father came in a small boat, illegally, to Palestine, and came to a kibbutz near Haifa called Usha. My mother, she's Esther, her maiden name is Levi will be here. She was born in Kolozsvár or Cluj. This is the capital of Transylvania. Transylvania, at time, over the years, belonged occasionally to Hungary and sometimes to Romania. Unfortunately for her, it was in Hungary during the war. And because the Nazis didn't go to Romania, but they did go to Hungary in 1944 with Eichmann and them. So she was in Auschwitz. My father was not in Auschwitz, she was in Auschwitz. Didn't have a number, but she was liberated by Russians. And she came legally, so because the British had a quota, so she managed to come legally. And she came also to Usha, this is where she met my father. So they met in a kibbutz in Israel. They stayed there for a few years, decided to get married, and then they moved to a small town. This is where I was born, and my brother was born, and this is where I grew up. And what is little known, even for many people that live in Israel, is that the attitude of the local people in what we call now Israelis, but there was no Israel yet, towards the Holocaust survivor was not very complimentary. They looked down on them and they said, how come you went like a sheep to the slaughter? How come you didn't fight, you didn't revolt?
Yeah, right.
Well, actually, all the revolts, really, it was good for feeling good, but they really didn't do anything. And for me, I always thought that the heroism of my parents was to go through this harrowing experience and to maintain your humanity and dignity as human beings, and to come to, so they came to Palestine to 45, this was 3 years before Israel was established. They still had to go through wars, but they were Zionists. They both of them wanted to come to Palestine long before the war, but they couldn't get certificates. So they knew Hebrew when they came to Israel, and they spoke fluent Hebrew. And so they wanted to have a family, which for me is kind of remarkable. After all of this, still want to start new life, which is I'm grateful for. And so now I want to tell you what it was like for me to grow up as second generation. I from very early age that I remember, I knew about the Holocaust. I knew the history of my parents. They did talk about it, not necessarily all the time, but when we prompted, they would tell stories. For example, there's this story that I remember about my mom. My mom is right-handed. But whenever she would cut something, she would use her left hand. So I asked her, how come you use your left hand? She said, well, you know, I had to peel potatoes in the camps in Auschwitz. And when the right hand was no longer used, I had to switch to the left hand. And it stayed with her. And everything that she had to do with cutting was done with the left hand. So that was the things that you know use. But they always talked about it kind of matter-of-factly. It's not we were victims. This is what it was. We had to go through it, and we did it. And it was... So I grew up with knowing what they went through. And I read the diary of Anne Frank probably from the time I could read dozens of times. And you know, every time I would get to the end, I would hope maybe this time she would perish. But you know, that would happen. So I always could see myself in everyone that went through the Holocaust, children and adults. It was, I could see myself in them. And my father's brother, Yoshua, this is taken in his 80th birthday. He's 1 year older than my father, and they went through the Holocaust together. He always tells me, he's still alive. My father died in 2004. He's still alive. And he said, if you're alone there, you had no chance. You had to be with someone to survive. Mm. So, our household, I mean, my mother had issues, you know, with bipolar, and who knows if it's because of the Holocaust or not, we don't really know. And health issue, but it wasn't a sad or depressed place. We have I had a very happy childhood, and very rich in, my father didn't earn a lot, but he worked for agriculture school. And we went to see plays and musicals and movies. So cultural, it was very rich. We also spent a lot of time, the four of us, my brother and my parents and myself, playing word games, Scrabble, and card games. So we spent a lot of time together. There was a lot of laughter in the house. It wasn't depressing. In spite of the fact that I think the fact that they survived the Holocaust, it always was there, but it not necessarily was looming heavy on us all the time. And sorry, just make sure that I don't forget. So for me, when I was in my early 20s, I think I heard the first time second generation. Before I just was, I didn't even know that there was a term. Then my cousin gave me a book to read about it, and I started reading and I said, it says there are issues to make a long-term relationship. Check. Yeah. Oh, wow, I have an excuse for everything. No, this is not right for me, never mind that. So for me, really, as far as I'm concerned, the second generation I don't think it has formed me in a negative way, but you can be the judge of that. But I always, for me, it was kind of always a badge of honor. And I thought, double badge of honor for both sides. Like we are very close with my cousin and the son and daughter of my uncle. And their mom is from Denmark, but the Jews of Denmark, because of the King of Sweden, they really escaped the Holocaust. So we thought, they're only half at time, full-blooded, as if it was kind of a blue blood. So it was always something that, yes, it's something to be proud of, because I think the way my parents carried themselves. And so now I want to tell you how I think being a second generation formed me as who I am. When I try to make the list, there are a couple of things that I think I am who I am because of who my parents are. Well, regardless of the Holocaust, my values, my attitude to religion, loving life, wildlife, all of this. This I don't think had anything to do with the Holocaust, but there are four things that I think do have to do with it. The first one is the importance of education. And I don't remember ever my parents telling us, my brother and myself, that you have to go to college or something, but it was kind of a matter of fact that either because they couldn't really get to high education or because it's something that was kind of a matter of fact, both of us did. And my parents, without any being able to go to college, my father spoke four languages, my mother six, and some a bit odder than others. My father had an array of dictionary, and he always tells me, you'll go from the Polish to the German to the English to find out how you say something in all of these languages. So it was always about learning. He probably would have loved to come to OLLI, that's for sure. So both my brother and I went to college. My brother in mechanical engineering, I went to computer science, and it was something just, it was very important always. The second thing is, I think, the ability to put difficulties in perspective. Said, okay, we have something that's coming now away, but we can pass that. So a kind of resilience that I think came from knowing, you know, they can went through that, I cannot trivialize something, you know. The third thing, I think, is self-reliance. It's, for me, it's still to this day very difficult to ask for help, so you have to do everything yourself. And the fourth, and I think the most important for me, is that since I remember myself, I always sided with the downtrodden, with the wrongly accused, with persecuted people, with the disenfranchised, whether it's the Armenians, whether it's Palestinians, whether it's homeless people, Rohingya in Burma, and anywhere in the world. It's just I immediately see myself in them, and I make myself getting informed about everything, and I'm trying to do something about it. Because I don't know if you remember, there was this really great documentary many years ago on PBS called Shoah by Claude Lanzmann. And something that stuck in my mind is he interviewed these Poles that lived in Auschwitz, and they asked him, didn't you know? He said, we didn't know, we didn't hear, we didn't see, we didn't smell, nothing. And for me, I think, I don't want what was not done for the Jews. I see that if I, you said, oh, I didn't know that it was happening, I'm doing the same to others. So for me, this is, it's really made me who I am, my social activism, my political views, and I think life in general. And one last thing that I want to say, that I think that my brother and I and my niece and nephew are the best answer and the sweetest revenge that my parents could have against those that wanted to destroy them.
Thank you.
So now, if there are any questions?
Why were they moved from one camp to the other? What was the purpose of that? Do we know?
It's just, you know, that's... Whenever the Nazis tried to, they needed something. My father was always very skillful. So, you know, just for something that could use him better.
I see. Thank you.
Were your father and brother always in the same camps, even when they moved?
Yes, they were. Very lucky for them, they were the whole time together, yes.
And what about your mother? Was she with others? Well,
my mother, when she got to Auschwitz, she was with her mom and her sister, and they, you know, they did selection, so they were selected to the other side, right there. My mother was, by the way, one of five, and two of her brothers, the sister died and one of the brother died, and two of her brothers did survive. One of the brothers participated in an organization that helped Jews escaped. The Nazis caught him one time and carved a swastika on his chest. But they both came to Israel, so they were all in Israel.
When did you come to the States, and why?
I arrived in 1982, and I was working in Israel in a company that was bought by an American company. And they suggested to some of the people to come here. And I thought, for 6 months, it would be a nice adventure. It's been a long 6 months.
The term, the second generation, is interesting how that came about. When you think of how many generations there are in the Jewish culture, and yet you're the second generation. You recall that story about why it's called the second generation? Because most of the history had been wiped out. Therefore, the first generation started with those in the camps.
Well, they were the survivors, and we are the one that came after. That's it wasn't used for anything for any other. I don't really know who termed it. I actually don't know. Yes.
Were they able to talk about their experience?
Yes, they did. Not all the time, not constantly. My uncle speaks about much more, and he remembers everything. But they did. Yes. It wasn't something hidden, you know, the people that really carry it as a wound. So they did talk about it, yes. Yeah.
And were their parents, did they not survive?
No.
Nobody.
And actually, is that something interesting that my father always, you know, the way my father, both my father and my mother, when they talked about the family, said my mother, my brother. So for me, I never could relate to them as my grandparents and my uncle and aunts, because they were never really mine. Mm-hmm. So they really, who they were for them, this is how they ended. Mm-hmm. So they were not really my relatives in any way.
Okay. I'm assuming of the six siblings your father had, only your father and his older brother.
Actually, they have one other that managed to arrive to Israel before the Holocaust. He arrived in 1933. And he lived here for a few years and then came in Israel and then came to Rhodesia and then United States. So he lived, yes.
And I wanted to ask you about your children.
I don't have any.
You don't have any children.
So this is one of the things, second generation.
I used to thank my grandfather for coming to America.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'd be dead.
Yeah. Oh, because it came, yeah,
sure.
Came in time, yes. But you know, they really wanted to. It's not that there were many Jews that didn't want to, but they were both my father's family and my mother's family. They were Zionists. They wanted to come to Israel, but the Palestine. But the British wouldn't let them. So you know, it's also a matter. The British were the good guys, but in that role, they did not play the good guys. Anything else? Yes.
Did they ever talk about what a day's life would be like what would they eat or what would they do, or were they working out in the fields? Or
I mean, I knew that when food was always very scarce, and my father also was sick a great deal of the time, typhus or something, they wouldn't say really in details, because I think this was probably too painful to remember. It just was, you know, we went through this, we did it, we had to. He used his skills a lot, his mechanical skills.
Have you met many other people who are second generation?
Oh, yeah, in Israel you can't escape it, even if you want to. Because I grew up with many, not all, that's why I said, you know, in my class, in my elementary school, there were many that came from North Africa. North Africa did not go through the Holocaust. But most of the people that came from Eastern Europe were, unless they managed to be early in Israel, most of them were. So it was very common to meet other people that...
Were their experiences at home similar to yours or different?
Well, you know, not everyone came out the way I am. I mean... Politically, or there are many people that went actually the other way and think, don't see the correlation necessarily. And there are also many Holocaust survivors that could not bring themselves to talk about it at all, wouldn't mention it. Mm-hmm. So I think there were many kids that grew up second generation and didn't even know it. Mm-hmm. Unless they really asked strongly. I don't even remember how it started, but I knew it from the way I remember myself. I knew about it, so I guess it just talked about it. But it's definitely not necessarily the same experience now.
For the ones who didn't, whose families did not talk about it, did the children have a different outcome? Did
Yeah, I'm sure they're down. I mean, I didn't really do any, but not necessarily. It could be that some of these things that were passed, even though, you know, some of the behavior was passed by the survivors, even though they didn't talk about it. It could be that some of the things still passed on.
I'm intrigued by the fact that your father somehow got to Israel or Palestine. Can you tell us a little bit more about how that helped, and when he got there? How did that turn out?
Well, there were a few organizations in Israel by Jews. One of them was called the Haganah, which means the defense. And they were trying to get the Jews to come to Palestine. So they organized all of this. I mean, the ship was probably, they had to scoop water out. I mean, it was really in bad shape. And some of them perished on the way, and some of them were caught by the British and put in Cyprus and in camps after the Holocaust.
Wow.
My father luckily did not go through that. Some of them stayed there for years, in camps after the Holocaust, by the British. So there were people from the local organization waiting for them, because my father had a relative in this kibbutz. This is how he ended up there. So did my mom. So then I think it depended if you had relatives or not. And you know, some of the Holocaust survivors that did not have anyone really felt very poorly in Israel too for many years because of the attitude, the local attitude, and didn't take care of them. And there were some that died in misery and alone. So the whole, I mean, bad and good, there is really, like most places, it's really convoluted, and there's very few that are only good and only bad. You can find all the mixtures.
Can you talk a little more about the attitude of people there? That why didn't you do more to resist? That's just.
Oh yeah, it was this. You know, we are the new breed. We are fighters. All of these sacred cows, you know, Masada, which also was another really, but it's still, you know, it's exalted because it's a revolt. It was also useless and just people died for nothing. Mm-hmm. So you grow up with this myth, and then come these people that were you know, put into camps and treated horribly. And it didn't belong, it didn't fit with a nice picture of who we are as a new Israelis.
Yeah.
So they were looked down on. And they had to fend for themselves still again, you know. I mean, not everyone, but it's a state. And as whatever government there was, they were not treated.
And the children were not affected too much by that, or how much were the kids?
Well, I didn't know really about it. I learned about it later, because my father was not someone that would complain anyway about anything. So.